Good evening, Cayman Islands. Reshma Ragoonath here, live at the A.L. Thompson Storm Center at the Compass Building. We are here with your latest update, and I'm happy to say I'm joined by Premier Wayne Panton, live from Government Admin, Premier?
Yes, that's where I'm currently located.
All right, so thank you so much for joining us this evening. Just for those who are joining us, what's the latest you can share with us in terms of the emergency response following Tropical Storm Grace?
Well, I think they've done a great job, and I spent some time with them earlier today. Certainly congratulated all of them, all those individuals who were operating from within, in the various teams from within the National Emergency Operations Center. I was joined by the Acting Deputy Governor, Ms. Gloria McPhail Nixon. The Deputy Governor is off on a well-deserved break at the moment, so he's missed all of the activity around this, and he's probably grateful for that. But I certainly think that they've done a really good job. I want to congratulate all of those individuals involved with the center, those individuals who represent the emergency operations, emergency services that we have. You know, we even had the, you know, members of the cadet corps in who were operating the call center. So it's a really impressive thing to watch a lot of fantastic people come together and motivated, driven by a desire to help the people of the country survive and you know, get through an event like this in the best possible way. So I'm really, really happy to see them operating in that way, and certainly congratulations to them. Things have been going quite well. I spent a couple of hours this afternoon. Unfortunately, a lot of it was in heavy rain squalls with the governor. We were touring various areas. A lot of the areas that are typically very hard hit.
Flooding and that thing. Sorry to interrupt you. One second. It seems that we're having some audio issues here. Just give me one second before you continue. I apologize. We're working with a generator here, so it's kind of hard to navigate right now. Let's just do one mic check. Don't move. Okay, apologies there, Premier. Live TV, that's what happens, right? So just to recap, I apologize. So you were telling us about the response today and the what you saw from the team there at the Emergency Command Center and on your tour as well.
Yeah, so I guess you want me to go back over everything, and that's fine. As I was saying earlier, I had the pleasure of spending time with the various teams at the National Emergency Operations Center today. I want to congratulate them for an excellent job well done. You know, the National Hazard Management and everyone involved with the operations of the Emergency Operations Center. I've done a great job at putting that together. Fantastic people involved, fantastic people working there that are committed to serving the interests of the people of the country and helping them get through an event like this and make sure that, you know, we come out of it in the best possible way. I spent a couple of hours as well with the governor touring certain hard-hit areas, particularly areas that have been very prone to flooding. We covered a number of those areas. Unfortunately, at that time, there was a lot of, you know, rain squalls going on, a lot of heavy rain. So we didn't have a chance to get out very much on, and certainly had a limited opportunities to speak with many people that were in those particular neighborhoods. But it was an opportunity to really give an indication to the governor. We were being escorted by members of the regiment. So it was really useful to have a discussion with the governor and sort of point out the areas that have had a long history of problems. And it's an opportunity for us to be very clear about where we need to direct our resources to basically address the needs of those that are hardest hit, and to make the greatest improvement in their lives in terms of the impacts they've been suffering. My team has been, my colleagues, I should say, have been out, as have I, probably quite a bit last night and from early this morning. As you can see, I haven't shaved. I left home. There was no power, no light to see by. And this is my second change of clothes for the day. I look a bit sort of wet, dry. And, we've just been on the road all day. We're now in the government, offices, for an early evening emergency meeting to discuss how we're going to address the needs of people of the country going forward, starting first thing in the morning. Mm-hmm. Obviously, we had a lot of people doing things today. We have a lot of great community-minded people who are out helping. A number of us were out ourselves. We have some of our own teams doing stuff. And we're going to continue that. Tomorrow morning, we've invited the leader of the opposition and his team, the rest of his opposition team members. So we want to have effectively a full meeting of all parliamentary members, all the 19 constituencies represented tomorrow morning in the government building here at 9 a.m. We're going to have a discussion about a plan that we are putting forward, which effectively involves the equivalent of an extraordinary constituency allowance that goes to each individual constituency to allow them to address the needs of their constituency, cleaning up the roads, helping helping people with cleaning up their yards, making sure that people lost a lot of fruit trees, for example. We want to try to help prepare them, get them pruned properly, and enable them to be able to get them reestablished so that they get growing again. We certainly want to minimize our tree loss. I'm the Minister for Sustainability, so mm-hmm. I'm all about trying to make sure that we continue with the amount of trees that we have and not have to start over after an event like this.
Definitely.
So it's been really good, and I want to congratulate my entire team. They've been doing a really good job being out there interacting with the constituents, understanding where the issues and problems are. We have some people that have had actual damages to their houses, mm-hmm. So it is definitely an event that involved more than just trees down. We have some people that have some leaks, have some damages from impacts like trees. We've had some houses that have lost some roof areas. So we are going to be working with them to try to ensure that we put them in the best possible position to reestablish their themselves. And, fingers crossed, you can never say never. We hope that this is the only event we have to deal with for the season. Mm-hmm. But it may not be. And, we've got to try to get people prepared as best as possible.
Okay, Premier, thank you for that. Now, you mentioned an allowance there. Do you have a figure that you're working with, or is that to be ironed out tomorrow?
It's approximately $15,000 per constituency. So we are going to have equipment provided, which will be some chainsaws and gloves and the usual stuff, machetes, mm-hmm. that type of thing. And we're looking to hire a couple of small teams of people. Some of us already have our own teams, but if not, others will be looking to get together some teams of people to work in these areas to do this kind of work. Mm-hmm. So it's not a significant amount of money on an individual basis. It's several hundred thousand dollars you know, for on a collective basis. But we're seeking to try to ensure that we address the needs of our all of the constituencies, not just those that are represented by the members of the PAC government.
Okay, now you mentioned that you had reports of damage. We saw some damage ourselves when we went out on the road, some roofs damaged, downed power lines, trees, etc. Have you had any reports of any serious injuries as a result of those?
No, thankfully we have not had any reports of any. I'm not even aware of any particular, even non-serious injuries. So thankfully, you know, that is the case. It seems there have been some commercial premises with some damages. We've had some poles, you know, I don't know the exact number, but we certainly have had some poles that were snapped off. I presume COC has been busy working on those. I think earlier in the day, there was a confirmation that COC would be looking to start doing the work to address these problems with the poles and try to get the power and back on, get homes re-energized. After the winds drop below about 30 miles an hour, so that it was safe for them to be operating their bucket trucks and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. I do know that they tried to reestablish power several hours ago, and there was a fail-safe that tripped in because the system detected a fault. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they have issued a statement specifically in relation to that, but the information that I have been briefed on is that the system detected a fault and it automatically tripped out in order to protect their system. And they indicated that effectively would set them back in their timeline by about 90 minutes. My understanding is that they were hoping to have at least half of their customers re-energized tonight. Mm-hmm. And then the other half they would be dealing with or being able to accomplish sometime in the morning. So obviously, it means that some of our people will go without electricity tonight, it seems. And that is a very unfortunate situation. And I know we do have certain people who depend on power for things like oxygen concentrators and, you know, or they need to keep their insulin cool and chill and this type of thing. So, you know, obviously, if people need any assistance, please reach out to your member, if your representative, your member for parliament. If you are not able to get them, reach out to any of us in the government, and we'll try to address those. You know, try to find a solution to help them resolve whatever need they have.
Now, this is the first time we actually saw the regiment deployed, and we saw them in action. What's your assessment of basically how they conducted the operations, and also your assessment of how the emergency command center itself operated today, because this was kind of like a dry run for an actual hurricane, although it was a tropical storm, as Hazard Management Director Danny Coleman was saying last night.
Yeah, I want to say, I mean, based on our experience this morning, and you know, most of the weather we started to feel after about 4 o'clock this morning, and by between 5 and 5:30 was when we really had some heavy weather. I would have to say that a lot of that weather was certainly in excess of what you would have in a Category 1, or at least Category 1's status. As I alluded to in my video message yesterday, you know, given that the forecast was showing a change from a tropical storm to a Category 1 hurricane right in our area, and I think the forecast was for it to happen within an hour or two of it passing us. I certainly feel that, you know, we probably felt the effects of a Category 1 hurricane in terms of the impacts we had. Maybe not in terms of a consistent timeline basis, but we certainly had winds that were well in excess of what would be considered a Category 1 status. I think the regiment performed very well. Obviously, this is an opportunity for them to identify that this is this is a wet run, not a dry run.
Yeah, that's definitely that it is.
Right, so it's an opportunity for all of us to identify where there are issues and where we can learn lessons and where we can make changes to make things better, improve resiliency, improve performance, improve delivery of service. But overall, I think they performed really well. They were testing a lot of the new equipment that they received. I didn't take a ride in some of it, but the governor did. In fact, the governor, as you may know, had problems this morning. He his residence was sort of blocked in with a lot of fallen trees, unfortunately. So his car couldn't go to pick him or couldn't take him out. But he had a ride in one of the regiment's vehicles to be delivered to the government building, which was, it was good for him to be able to experience that. And I think, as I said, I think they have performed quite well. It's an opportunity to figure out how to make it better next time. Every chance we get at this is an opportunity to learn a lesson as to how to improve. And these situations are always very dynamic. Nothing is really ever exactly the same. So, you know, the more times you're exposed to it, the more times you have to deal with these types of problems, the better you get at being able to adapt and respond to differing circumstances to make a difference and improve the approach and the level of service you provide. But overall, they've done a great job. I'm quite proud of the entire operation, the National Emergency Operations Center, National Hazard Management Team, have done a fantastic job. I think they have had, this is the first one for the year where they've had to respond in this way. So I think there was probably a little bit of a feeling of, geez, we were so busy last year, and now it feels like we're not sure whether we're doing everything right now, and maybe it feels a little bit clunky. But to be honest, that to me is normal. I wouldn't expect them to feel like what happened over the last day and a half was entirely normal, and that that they would. And to me, it's a good thing to feel like you need to improve. You're not certain if you're doing everything right, and you have a really open mind as to whether you can improve things. So, as I've said, I'm very proud of them, and I think that they will continue to be and to develop to be a great service to the country.
One of the questions that we've had coming in, and we did get an update from the civil service talking about what's going to happen tomorrow with government offices and should staff come in, that kind of thing. Is there any updates that you can provide to us for that in terms of what's going to happen at government offices and for civil servants?
To be honest, while we were talking, I had a call from the acting deputy governor, which I didn't take, but I will be speaking to her immediately after we complete this. So I will have a better idea of what they are thinking at this point. I think given the fact that we will have quite a number of our residents who will likely not have power restored overnight or by morning, the expectations have to be balanced. And I think I know the civil service take a very reasonable approach to these things, and they will give latitude to people. If they can work from home, they can work from home. If they don't have power, that's probably not likely. But they've got to be able to acknowledge that circumstances might dictate that they won't be able to get dressed and come to work as if it's a normal day. It's a half day. I don't know exactly, but I'm sure when I call the acting deputy governor back, she will give me a very clear briefing on what their intentions are in terms of requiring the civil service to come to work tomorrow at certain times or not. They are certainly very aware, and I think they will have had probably a more recent update from CUC in terms of the power. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, I haven't had time to get it.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Premier Wayne Panton, for joining us live here at the A.L. Thompson Storm Center at Compass Building. Any final thoughts before you say goodnight?
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, this is a great thing that you do, a good opportunity to have a discussion with people in the country. You know, I want to recognize and acknowledge that we, you know, we've come through this. Nobody's been hurt. We have had some damages. The government is very much concerned about making sure that we assist the people of the country. But there are some lessons that, you know, and some things that I think people need to continue to bear in mind, and that this is a clear indication and a reminder of why it's so essential for us to get prepared for these types of events. Because while this, to some people, was very scary, for those who have forgotten what it felt like in Ivan, or who weren't here, or perhaps weren't old enough to really appreciate this, the extent of that and the significance of that, this is a reminder of why we absolutely have to be as prepared as possible. I think, as we all know, we have the likelihood that these types of events can become more intense and possibly more frequent. Last year was a very extraordinary year in terms of the number of storms we had. And this year, you know, the jury's still out. We're not sure what's going to happen. The forecast is for it to be a busy year, maybe not as busy as last year, but who knows where it's going to end up. And fingers crossed, and with a lot of prayer and you know, a lot of preparation, we'll get through this year safely as well.
All right.
So I want to thank everybody who takes this very seriously, and I want to encourage everybody else to continue to do so. Thank you, and all the media who take these issues seriously and who help to present the information to the people of the country, which protects their safety and enables a better quality of life for them.
Thank you so much, Premier. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Take care. Have a good evening.
Take care. Bye-bye. All right. You just heard from Premier Wayne Panton. They're joining us live via Zoom here at the A.L. Thompson Storm Center at Compass Building, just giving us a sense of what has happened over the past 24 hours in terms of damages. Luckily, we have any reports of any serious injuries. However, we do have reports of damages. He did announce from this interview that tomorrow he has called a meeting with all 19 MPs to discuss $15,000 allowance for MPs to assist them with cleanup operations and for constituents who may require assistance. So I'm guessing, but I'm sure that we will have that update tomorrow following that meeting. Now, we are joined live by two our very own Vicky Wheaton, two guests on this Zoom interview, who are going to share with us their own experience, what is happening in their area. We have Vicky Wheaton, our living editor, and we have Bella Rooney, who is joining us via Zoom. Vicky, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Okay, so first of all, Vicky, tell us, what is the situation where you are right now, and what's the sight or sounds where you are?
Where I am is pretty quiet right now. We still don't have power.
Sorry.
Off West Bay Road.
One second. One second. Vicky, one second. Bella, can you mute? Oh, thank you. Okay, Vicky, sorry. Start over. We were getting a lot of feedback there.
No problem. Yes, I would hate for anybody not to hear every single word I have to say.
That is true. That is true.
So it's very quiet here. We live just off West Bay Road. So we had all the noises of the storm through the night, obviously. And then earlier in the day, in the afternoon, there was lots of traffic on West Bay Road. Not so much now. We went down there to take a look. Lots of plant life down, but apart from that, Yeah, I mean, we have water, but we have no power, so we're not sure when that's going to come back on at the moment. But overall, I said, apart from plants and trees down, we're okay. It's just been, it's a real shame when you see huge trees down, sort of plants and bushes, okay, but when you see really big trees down that take years and years and years to grow, and I've read Facebook messages of friends of mine that have lost mango trees and avocado trees, that's really hard because those take years to grow back.
Definitely. Now, Vicky, tell us a little about your experience during the passage of Hurricane Grace. What was it like for you?
To be honest with you, the house is fairly well insulated against sound, and I think a lot of it comes down to that for people. We went to sleep fairly late at night. I managed to sleep through most of the evening, and then I was probably woken up at about 5 or 6 o'clock by the sound of wind and rain. I will say that as the night was progressing, sort of 1 in the morning, 2 in the morning, because I was still up at that time, I have to admit, I was going, oh, maybe it's not going to be a huge event, because we have had so many instances where we thought we're going to have a big storm, or then we're going to have a storm, and then at the last minute, it kind of changes course, and we don't get a big impact. And I was beginning to think that would be the same, but of course, that completely changed. That opinion changed by early in the morning, 5, 6 p.m. I mean, the wind and rain. More the wind, I was expecting a lot more rain early on, but more the wind was knocking all the trees. And I remember thinking, wow, I was not expecting it to be of this level. I just wasn't. I mean, I've lived here long enough that we've gone through a number of storms. I was here for Gilbert. I was here for Ivan. And you kind of go, okay, Ivan was a Category 5. I will put my hand up and say I thought this was going to be basically like a strong nor'wester. And it was much more than I anticipated.
That's funny you should mention nor'wester, because yesterday I interviewed one of the boaters who was tying his boat up at Morgan's Harbor, and he was saying, you know, this is going to be, it's not going to be that bad, but I think now we all see that we can't just, to the premier's point, you know, we can't just take it for granted. We need to be prepared because things change. It's Mother Nature, very unpredictable.
It absolutely is. You're right. And let's face it, we were looking at almost if we were going to be hit directly, we were looking at a best case scenario. It was going to be a tropical storm. It wasn't going to be a hurricane, although I do think we all agree that we were probably on the cusp of, if not in the middle of, an early Category 1. So we had that. But the storm was moving so quickly. 14 to 16 miles per hour forward movement. Nothing like Ivan, which hovered over us for a long, long period of time. So, and we were coming into low tide earlier in the morning by about, I think, 9 or 10 a.m., we were expecting low tide. So all of those factors, you think, yeah, it is. It's basically going to be like a bad nor'wester. And after seeing something like this, there have been a number of comments I've seen, people, friends of mine on Facebook, that have gone, wow, we didn't imagine it was going to be like this. And we almost had a best case scenario of tropical storm. So I'm sure that after this, people are now going to be going, okay, now I do need to, I didn't fill my bath with water. I didn't do it. I mean, I have a cistern at the house, but I didn't. I thought, what are the odds the water is going to be a problem? So, but now you kind of go, okay. And maybe it's been a good thing. It's not been a terrible, terrible hit. I'm not saying there aren't people that haven't been affected, because I know they've been roofs down and so forth. But maybe this is something that needs to give all of us a kick and go, all right, I do need to be prepared for even what seems to be a smaller threat over a hurricane.
All right. Thank you so much, Vicky. I appreciate that. And I hope power is restored to you quickly as well.
Fine, Resh. But thank you for all your work as well. You've done a fantastic job. I know you've been working a lot of hours on this story. And thank you so much for your work.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Andral is here with me as well, trucking away as we continue to keep the community informed. I'm going to switch now to Bella Rooney, who is also on this Zoom call. Vicky, I'm going to ask you to mute your mic if not.
Yes, don't worry. I shall mute away. In fact, I'll leave it. Don't worry.
Thank you. Thank you, Vicky. I appreciate. Hi, Bella. Good evening. Can you hear us? Can you tell us, first of all, what was your experience like? Where were you when Tropical Storm Grace hit?
Yes, hi. I was just at South Sound right by South Church Street. I wasn't, again, much, very similar to Vicky's experience. I wasn't expecting it to be what it was, and I went to bed blissfully thinking I was going to wake up and I'd get through the day and I'd be done by, I don't know, 12. I hadn't really paid much attention, which is totally on me. And when I woke up around 5 o'clock, I heard the wind like whipping around the corners of my house, and I was like, holy moly. We had a few trees down in the neighborhood. We had two big ones down in our front yard. Mm-hmm. And then when we had a lull, I took my dog out, went for a little walk, and inspected, talked to some of the neighbors to find out that then there was more coming. I was so unprepared. And with that last band and all that rain, my house had some pretty big leakage, and I was wringing out towels for the rest of the day until it stopped.
Oh, no. So are you okay now? Do you have power where you are? What's the situation right now?
No, not yet. No power yet. No power as of yet. I got lots of candles, got lots of lanterns. So I'm just going to wait it out. And I'm so grateful to those guys that are out there right now trying to make this happen for us.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Bella. I appreciate you joining us for this Zoom call and for giving us some of your experiences. Have a good evening.
No worries. Thank you. You too.
All right. And just before we wrap up, this is our last live broadcast for tonight here from the AL Thompson Storm Center. Just to recap, if you do have any sort of damages at home or require any assistance, you can call 911. Also, if you are able to, the hurricane shelters are open, so you can make use of those facilities, the closest one to your location. Police will be out in high numbers to ensure, as they've indicated, ensure visibility, manage crime. And for those of you who are working in government offices, the latest update we have had from the Government Information Services is that government offices in Grand Cayman will remain closed for the morning and will reopen at 1 p.m., any civil servant offering non-essential services who needs to address any personal circumstances impacting their work are requested to contact their manager as early as possible ahead of tomorrow's 1 p.m. reopening. And those who require or who provide essential emergency services are required to attend work as scheduled unless otherwise directed. So that's a quick update from the civil service as we close our coverage tonight here at the Cayman Compass. We just want to thank you for staying with us. I want to give a big shout out to our assistant intern extraordinaire, Miss Dominique Thomas, for joining us and helping out here as we continue to bring you live coverage. And of course, to my colleague, Andrel Harris, who has been out and about with me and as well as directing behind the scenes, ensuring that we get the information that you need out to you. I'm Reshma Ragoonath on behalf of the Cayman Compass team. Have a good night, Cayman.